Thank you. What's up, everyone, and welcome to FAQ 142. Last FAQ I had was a complete success. It was the one FAQ where I brought it all back. I'm back, baby. Back with the FAQ. However, it's gonna be really tough to top that one. You know, I had skateboarding, I was showing all of my guitar, I was just bringing out everything for that one. And that will not happen today. Today, we're back to shit. Okay, so let's just go. By the way, if you have any questions, post them in the comment section of this video. And maybe, I don't know, it has to be a good question. Let's just go for the sake of, you know, going. Flow Dust, hi Ola, we just recorded our first EP and we are thinking about getting the mastering getting done by a much more expert in the death metal genre than our studio guy. Is that a good idea? Great question. I would say yes and no. I would say it's probably a really, really good idea to have a separate set of ears actually taking a listen and gander on your music. Usually that can give a certain type of perspective to the music that maybe you know haven't thought of before. But you know, having that extra set of ears and that mastering guy might not always be the best solution for you and your situation. I would probably say the absolute best is just to get a mixer that you truly trust and let him do the mastering for you, because then you have the one and the same guy with you throughout the whole production and you kind of build your expectations with this producer. If you give your recording and your production to a separate mastering guy, he might hear something completely different and your music might end up sounding way different than you anticipated, and it didn't sound like you expected. But I would personally be a little bit more confident in, you know, having the producer and engineer actually do the mastering section as well. Just so, you know who you're working with the full way. But then again, why not just try it out? Try another mastering engineer. See, maybe he'll do wonders. And if he does not, well, go back to your original guy and let him do the master. I mean, there's always the option, okay? Steamed Hands, Yola, I've been thinking, you haven't released an album since you left Randall, at least with The Haunted or Feared. And that begs the question, have you thought about what amps you'll be using in future releases? If so, what models have you considered? Even though you might not think so, but this is actually not something I've thought about. For all I care, all that matters is that the end results sound good. At this point where I'm at right now, I don't really care what amplifier is being used or if it's a plugin, as long as it sounds good on the album. My Sun and the Moon single, that was a Marshall JVM that Ehrman had. He reamped those. And I don't fucking care. Those sounded good. Maybe for the next album I'll bring out, you know, my Mesa or something like that. You know, we'll just have to see whatever will fit the type of production I want. Maybe the next Feared album will sound super different. I have no idea. So I think this decision has to happen whenever I'm in that state of making that production. So right now I can't really say, but I'm open to using anything basically at this point. You know, I'm not tied to anyone. And that's an amazing feeling. Rude Maddie P88. Yo Ola, not a question, but we'll have one. Fuck it. But thanks for all the amazing content. I always get a smile watching your videos and your riff challenges have inspired me to write and play better. Thank you. Who is your favorite non-metal guitarist that inspires you to better yourself? First of all, thank you so much. Those are really, really kind words. I'm just thinking a little bit about this question. What guitar player inspires you to better yourself? So you're saying, make me better as a person or as a guitar player? Probably as a guitar player, I would say. As of right now, there's not really that much that inspires me, to be honest. I think life events inspire me more. You know, like family, you know, kids. My kids inspire me a lot, and you know, Louise as well. Music, maybe not that much at the moment. I've been listening a little bit to funk lately. A lot more, actually. I've been trying to, you know, up my funk game. You know, I enjoy funk. I've been listening a fair bit to Fearless Flyers, and you know, it's just really fun to listen to. But other than that, there's not really something that makes me want to better myself, other than, you know, me just pushing my limits whenever I need to write something, or, you know, when I'm making these videos, trying to push my limit with these videos. Okay, I'll go with Corey Wong, because he's the guitar player in Fearless Flyers right now. So, right now, okay, it changes. Tomorrow it might be, you know, Mike Tyson, for all I care. Just saying. Legendary K4, have you ever recorded? Dude, look at that small little two-year badge right there. This guy has been a member for 2 years. Just saying, what a legend. You have a fitting name for legend, just saying. Legendary K4, have you ever recorded a riff, but when you went back to it, you completely forgot how to play it? Yes! This is everyday struggle for me, man. Everyday struggle. I record something here in Logic, I go back a couple of months after, wondering what the fuck was I doing? What the hell was I thinking? And where on the neck did I actually play it? That's something I really struggle with. A good thing about this is now when I record an album, I at least try to make tabs for it. So it's easy for me to get back, you know, to learn a solo and whatnot and just, you know, see where I was working. Because, I mean, there's so many possibilities on the neck. Like, where did I actually play this solo? Was it here? Was it here? Was it here? So I started making tabs and videos of myself playing the stuff. You know, just to quickly get back into it, if needed. If I need to go play with the Haunted and, you know, the Haunted, we haven't even played in like a year and probably won't play until next year. And that's definitely a problem. I probably have to check my videos on how to play some of the songs in the set to be able to play them, to be honest. But yeah, happens all the time and that's okay. I don't know if it's a struggle for you, but for me, yes, it is a struggle, and thank you for bringing that problem up. Nick Rooning, question. Hi, Ola and Luis. What's next for the artist series? Will there ever be an A1.7 artist RD LTD? Ah, my good friend. You know what the rule is with solo guitars? We don't speak about what's happening in the future. It's impossible for me to answer this question. I can tell you that there are more artist guitars coming, but I can't tell you what's gonna happen. But I'm not going to discuss it with you, because that would spoil all the fun. SMLP, 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 suck my little penis, yeah. Friendly Fire, Olachen. Question, how do you find the perfect length, height for your guitar belts? For me, it feels like a compromise between playing comfortably high versus looking cool low. In your case, do different guitars or playstyle require different lengths? I don't know if it's taboo to talk about this, but as you say, a lot of people actually measure coolness with how high or low you keep your guitar on you when you're using a strap. I'm using this right now, I'm putting on a mono strap that I found. And let's just see what would be a good height for me. You know, I have a problem. And, whoa and behold, I have a problem. You know, I would love to have my guitar very, very low. But I have a problem. My problem is my picking technique, unfortunately. And I'm gonna show you why in a second. Okay, let me put this on. Look at this asshole. Can I stand? Will you be able to see? Look at this. Yeah, right off the bat, this right here. It's way too low for me, unfortunately. If I was a rhythm guitar player in a band, you know, this would do. You know, I could stand in a rhythm like... Problem is, I'm playing leads as well, and that's a problem. The problem is actually not my left hand, the problem is my right hand, and it's because of my picking technique. So, I've showed my picking technique before. Ooh. I almost dropped the guitar there. I have a very weird picking technique where it's almost like I'm angling backwards the pick like this. Most people play like this. Which makes a lot of sense. You can rock out like this. Since I'm not playing like this, I'm playing like this. Which, as the guitar gets lower, I kind of have to follow with my arm right here. So, because I need to retain this angle that I have. So I can't really put the guitar too low. I can't go here. Even though it looks cool. So because of my picking technique, I actually have to have my guitar a little bit higher. Adjusted. I mean, I think this is a really good height right here for me. Up here doesn't make you look cool, does it? I mean... I play metal, I need to look cool. So down here is okay. Shit, this feels so unfamiliar. I haven't played live in a good while, so I haven't stood up and played guitar, but... I think this right here is probably where I would place the guitar on me if I was playing live. Which is a little bit in between, you know, having it low and having it high. I'm pretty lagom, as we say in Sweden. Pretty moderate. You know, not too hot, not too cold, a little bit lukewarm. That's me. Great. Philip Gruber. Hey Ola, hope everything is going well. First of all, thanks for the great content and for bringing back the FAQs to your channel. My question is, can you talk a little bit about the Lavalier you use and how you process it? Also, if you have any tip about getting a good Lavalier, I think your voice always sounds crispy, not roomy, and nicely compressed. Now we are getting down and dirty and nerdy with microphones right here. Right now I'm using a AKG Lavalier microphone, and I have that directly hooked up into my interface. So, you know, I bothered with wireless microphones before and stuff like that, but it's just a hassle with batteries and shit. When I sit at my desk like this, or, you know, when I do a sitting down demo, I always kind of route a cable to the interface or whatever. It's just, yeah. This sounds really good. All I do is put on like a, you know, a FabFilter compressor. That's it, basically. When I do want to use something wireless, for instance, when I do my guitar videos over there, I use this that I got sent from Rode. The fuck is the name? I don't know what the name is, but it's basically a wireless microphone that I clip onto my camera, and I got a wireless microphone. It sounds all right. I think the AKG sounds a lot better, but for the sake of just having the freedom to be wireless, this is more than enough. Rode something pod... Rode Lavalier, Mike? Is that the name? Shit, I'm the worst. Oh, shit! People have been saying, Ola, you missed a question from Keith Merrow's FAQ. Well, the problem is that people don't understand that, you know, we release somewhat here and there, and, you know, we record our videos. It's not really easy to keep track when someone posts a question and versus when I'm recording the next thing. When someone posts a question and when I'm gonna record my next FAQ. So that's just how it is. Anyway, I'm gonna answer his question right now.
Question I have for you, Ola, is when you were just getting into metal, when you were growing up and getting into death metal, I know you were into bands like Bolt Thrower and bands like that. Were there ever any underground Swedish death metal bands that never really made it outside of Sweden, outside of Stockholm, or, you know, were there any local bands that were just totally crushing it that never really got the recognition that they deserved? That's a question I have for you.
All right, that's a great question. Now, I think it might sound weird for you guys, but during the 90s when I started listening to metal and going to shows, Swedes were very, very spoiled. In the sense that, you know, we had all of these awesome metal bands, you know, melodic metal bands playing, and death metal bands for his, I mean, Edge of Sanity and, you know, In Flames, Dark Tranquility, The Crown, and Tomb. Bands like that weren't as big as they are today, but those guys were playing frequently in Sweden. So we were spoiled because we were watching all these awesome bands before they actually blew up for real. So it's really weird today to see all of these bands kind of, you know, blew up and became really, really big and successful. So all of those underground bands during the 90s, they all kind of, you know, became successful, which I'm really, really happy for. But other bands that I want to mention that I was kind of like, you know, playing with my bands that I had back in the day and that I've always thought were kick-ass. Like a band like Source of Ignition, for instance. Slow Life. I mean, there were a lot of underground bands that we played a lot with because we shared the same underground scene. Check out those bands. They are most excellent. So I'm going to return the favor and come up with a question for Keith. Keith. So Keith, you're in Portland, and I imagine you and I being the same age, you know, Seattle is fairly close, I would say. During the 90s there, where, you know, I started listening to metal, I started listening to grunge, right? And a lot of the bands that I listened to, you know, Mudhoney and, you know, Nirvana and all those, Soundgarden, they all kind of originated from Seattle. Did that affect you in any way? I mean, you were living close to these bands. Did that grunge era sort of affect you at all, or, you know, did it just pass by? Were you ever into any grunge bands? Let me know. Thank you. The Boricua Wookie. Hey Ola, why don't you use your Hesu 2x12 cab anymore? I love the sound of your oversized Mesa, but I always wonder what happened to it, considering that it was used so heavily in your channel a while back. Okay, thank you. Ever since I bought my Mesa, that has been my favorite cabinet. And, you know, I just want to play it always. And, you know, I have my Forden as well over there. That's an excellent cabinet. I still have my 2x12s over here from Hesu. And, you know, maybe I'll make a shootout out of all of these. I think I need to make a cabinet shootout overall. I need to get more cabinets and just, you know, compare a little, I think. The only problem I have with cabinets is that, one, they're heavy, two, they're big, they take a lot of space, and three, they're heavy. To answer your question, I will definitely, you know, use my 2x12s more in upcoming videos, okay? I promise. Great. Daniel Canaparo. I've asked this 1,000 times already. Where is the Team Cart cart? All right. Hopefully you guys won't be disappointed by this, but I've actually already retired the Team Cart cart. You know, I felt that the cart was maybe a little bit too beautiful for my studio. So, you know, I took it home and now I'm just gonna let it be a cart for the rest of its life. But I have a substitute. You know, I got this cart. And I know what you're gonna say. It's definitely not as classy looking as my original cart. But you know what? This right here, it's a really good cart. You know, it's empty now, but I plan to, you know, put my microphones on here and, you know, maybe a little bit of cables down here, maybe my phone while I'm filming. You know, okay, let's leave the phone over there. Like that? Did you see? Let's do it again. For you who missed, here it is again. See? You know, sometimes I feel very proud to be a Swede. Thank God for IKEA, man. And that, my friends, was the last question. If you enjoyed this FAQ, please put a thumbs up, maybe subscribe, also push that notification bell. And if you have any questions, you post them in the comment section of this video. Maybe I'll feature your question in the next FAQ. Deal. Thank you.